good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. It's good to see every single one of you. God's brought us in just as we are without one plea, but that his blood was shed for us. Amen. What a good work he's begun. We believe in what he's done and where he's taken us. And we can be assured that he says, I know the plans I have for you. We need to believe those. Those are not just trite words we just ramble off. I know the plans I have for you. To give you a hope and to give you a future. Amen. And sometimes when you're on the journey, you don't always see it, right? And now it's like, it's wonderful when it comes in and you're just going, yeah, this is more like it. And so there's a cooperating with the Holy Spirit. And that's why we're taking this series on wisdom, because we need wisdom. Wisdom is the know-how, how to do life, how to understand, how to communicate, how to have a worship service. This was awesome this morning. Good pulling. It takes everybody. Amen. And the praise is so important, and the worship is so important, everything in the ministry time. And we're all still learning. Me too. I'm still learning. It's like, okay, God, the thought came to me, why when the anointing is so beautiful after we've broken through, do so often we just break up? So it's like, that's when our hearts are so tender for the Lord to do some ministry time. So expect ministry and open your heart to that. When you go to the dentist, you got to open your mouth, right? And so we got to open our mouths. We've got to open wide our hearts. Paul says, open wide your hearts to me, O Corinthians. I open wide my heart to you. So open wide your hearts to one another. Open wide your hearts to the Word of God. And expect that miracles are happening and there are transformations happening and that you're growing. And that which is not of God is being evaporated and just dissipates, and it disappears. And have you ever had a fight with somebody, your husband or wife or something, and you're going a few days later, you know, you're trying to bring, and you're going, I don't even remember what it was about. Right? What was so huge is like that. Well, the Lord just does that. He just takes it away when our hearts are open wide to him and we allow him to do what he wants to do. And that's so that ministry time. So I'm just learning and growing and feeling like my spirit's expanding from taking this wisdom. Probably bigger than any subject ever that I could feel is my life's message and my heart's desire is for people to come into intimacy and to know their time with the Lord is sweet and beautiful. Then when they come, we all come together. We all come together like torches, and we all come together bringing something and full and overflowing. And that's like the fountain, I guess, I saw this morning. It's like that fountain. When we go out into the world, we can offer them a drink because we've had a drink. Amen. And so as we studied last week, we looked at the wisdom of how to have bring in the presence corporately in a service, in a celebration service like we're having this morning. But probably bigger on my heart is people's one-on-one 24/7. How you start your day is so vitally important. Amen. It's how you start your day. So I want to talk to you about practicing the presence. So wisdom, how to practice the presence of God in your own private devotions. And there, again, like we looked at last week, there is biblical way. God's ways work. Amen. God, Jesus is wisdom. Jesus, remember the first message on wisdom. Wisdom personified is Jesus. And so how do we have that intimacy with Jesus? And we could cut it. I could teach it from so many different angles. There's a tabernacle prayer. Youngie Cho teach this way. There's the Lord's Prayer when the disciples said, teach us how to pray. And they saw Jesus going, as his word says in Mark chapter 1, 35. It says, Jesus, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up. He left the house and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. This was Jesus's practice. This was Daniel's practice. They knew if they could shut Daniel down and shut his prayer life down, that he would lose his power. Jesus knew that's where his power came from. Right after that passage, he goes out and heals a man from leprosy. This man comes and begs him, "Will you heal me? If you're willing, you can make me clean." And he said, he was indignant. He was indignant with that spirit that kept that man bound. And he says, I do will. Be clean. Jesus knew he was dependent. He came 100% as a man. Yes, he was 100% fully God. But when he came to the earth, he operated 100% in the same anointing, dependency on his Father, dependency on the Holy Ghost that we have available to us. And so how are we ever going to reach the world for Jesus? How are we going to see revival no matter how badly we want to see it? And yet we just go, God, how does this work? And that is wisdom. How is this going to work? We know the promises of God, the word of God, and we desire that. But how do we make it? How did Jesus make that work, that power work? Well, he had to start in a quiet time with his Father. So that this became his very, very priority. This is my very big priority. It has been since I got born again. And I just thank the Lord for the grace. I don't know how else to cut it. Probably my biggest frustration is to seeing a powerless body of Christ, frustrated Christians, not knowing how to do life. And it's because I would say start with A. And so that started this journey. I broke it down into ABCs for you so you can remember. To make it really easy. So I've taught it from the angle of the Lord's Prayer. But A is we have to affirm. We want to affirm and just remind ourselves, acknowledge and affirm that our Heavenly Father wants to be with us. See, when I wake up, whether it's 6 o'clock or whatever, Lord, sometimes it's 3 o'clock, I wake up. My first inclination is there's a switch that goes off on the inside of me. That's the Holy Ghost. And it's that call to prayer. It's a desire to pray. That's not me. Ever since I got born again, this switch, my kids are my witness, my husband's my witness. I'm the one, first one up, and I get out of bed, put on my socks, put on my hoodie, turn up the heat, and hit the deck in prayer, in praise, and in worship. Because, see, I know my Father wants to spend time with me. And so, A is for affirm, and just acknowledge, God, you want to be with me, and I want to be with you. How do we know that God wants to be with us? And that's where we need to go to the Word. We know because of the Word and the pattern right through the Word. From Adam and Eve, God's desire was to have you. When a husband and wife get together, isn't it amazing, this mystery? Grace and I probably, if we were to calculate the hours we talked about this during our childbearing years, it would just, we just kept going, here we are talking about it again. How awesome it is when a husband and wife come together and make a baby. And what they look like and who they look like. It's like, really, you think they look like so-and-so? I think they look like you. And you just go on and on because you're in awe and you're in wonder about this little creation that is part of both of you. And the Father feels the same way about every single one of you. He was so excited. Like we sang this morning before we took our first breath, we've got a brand new baby here. Melissa and Clayton just brought their brand new baby boy. Couldn't wait to see it. Amen. Let's give him a hand. He's little Felix, isn't that? Little Felix. I just couldn't help but say, oh, Felix the cat. Little Felix, which he means happy. Again, both babies mean happy. They're going to have one happy household, I'll tell you. But how amazing is it that you just see this little person for the first time? And that's just us. The first time I saw any one of my grandbabies is like, oh my goodness, this is so amazing. First time I pushed a little Alicia around, I went, who are you, little person? Hi, I'm Omi. And you just, there's an instant love. Like, How does that work? It's because we were made in God's image, amen? So he created Adam and Eve in this perfect environment, and it said Adam walked with God, and he talked with God, and they talked in fellowship like best friends, creator, father and son, in this wonderful atmosphere, this wonderful presence of God. Adam knew the presence of God. Eve knew the presence of God. So we need to affirm when we come to the Lord, Father, you want to be with me. He was with them through the wilderness in a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire by night, day and night, night and day. He was with them. His heart's desire, God's heart's desire was always to be with us, spend time with us. How can you have a relationship with somebody if you don't spend time with them? And if you say, I love my husband, I love my kids, I love my grandkids, how can you not want to do life with them? I know my grandkids love me because as soon as I see them, they don't stop whining. I want to come to your house. I want to come to Omi's house. Omi, can I come to your house? It just doesn't stop, and it's relentless. That's because we love each other. And so if our hearts don't do that when it comes to being with the one who created us, who knows us, who's our Heavenly Father, then we need to get born again. We need to get born again. You need to know that you have a Heavenly Father. You need to say, okay, pretend I never got saved. I need to get saved this morning. I need to give my heart and my life to Jesus all the way. And then something will wake you up in the morning. You say, I got to spend time with him or this day is going to be a write-off. So we wake up and we affirm, thank you, Father, you've shown Jesus came to be with one of us, left heaven to be one of us. I mean, why did he do that? Because he wanted to restore that relationship with us. Amen. So it's so important when we come in the morning, it's kind of cold or whatever, and we come, thank you, Father. I want to be with you this morning. His word says if we draw near to him, he will draw near to us. I'm coming here because I want to be near you, God. And so I'm drawing near to you. I thank you, you're drawing near to me, God. And sometimes we have to affirm that. Even as husbands and wives, you know, sometimes guys, you need to use your words more. And so, you know, it's to say, you know, I had a busy week, but I want to spend time with you. I miss you. Tonight is our night. You know, that's just affirming. I want to be with you. I miss you. Amen. And so we need to affirm that sometime. It's like, oh, okay. Amen. Don't we? We need to affirm. I see a few little nudges going on here. Amen. That just is. So we need to do that with the Father. That goes a long way, guys. That goes a long way, using your words. Amen. I want to spend time with you. There's nothing I'd rather do than turn off the dog and TV and use your words and make it known this is what I choose to do. I choose to spend time with you. And that's what we're doing. We're affirming that with our Heavenly Father. I could use an hour of sleep, Jesus. You know I'm feeling what I'm feeling this morning. But thank you more than anything. I know I need to spend time with you. And so I'm just affirming I want to spend time with you too. Amen. So that is important. That's your A. Amen. His name is Emmanuel. That means God with us. There's clues all through the word that God wants us to spend time with us. And so that's the A. Affirm that God wants to be with you and say, God, I want to spend time with you. I want to connect with you. I want this to be real and I want to know that I've had my time with Jesus. And then B is for blood. You cannot come into the throne room. You cannot come into the presence of God without your access card. The only way you can come into the presence of God is through the blood. Even Jesus had to come into the presence of God, his Father, through the blood. It says so. I'm going to give you scripture in Hebrews. First, I think the first scripture I got down there is Hebrews 10:19, I believe, yes. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place, by the blood of Jesus, a new and a living way was opened for us through the curtain. Remember the curtain was torn? That curtain is his body. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, full of assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from any guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. So we say, Lord, I come into you, Father. I thank you. You want to be with me. I want to be with you. I'm drawing near to you. And you said you draw near to me, Jesus. I'm coming through with the blood of Jesus. Thank you, God. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. I come through you by your blood. And then the chapter before in verse 23, it was necessary then for the copies of heavenly things to be purified with these sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these, referring to the blood of bulls and goats. For Christ did not enter a sanctuary. Listen, so this is Jesus. He did not enter the sanctuary made with human hands. It was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself now to appear for us in God's presence, nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood. Otherwise, he would have to come over and over and suffer many times, but he's appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. So Jesus offered himself. He offered his blood when he died on the cross. He went to heaven and he offered his blood before he could come in the presence of the Father. That's protocol. If Jesus had to come through the blood, and without blood, there's no forgiveness of sins, there's no access, do you think we would have to cover ourselves with the blood? Now, it might sound like, what's this with this church, the blood? And some people don't talk about the blood anymore because it might sound weird to non-believers. But to believers, it is. There is no sacrifice for sin outside of the blood. And so that's what Jesus did. He died on the cross, sacrificed his blood, took it to the Father. So, Father, I thank you when we have our prayer time that you want to be with me. I want to be with you. I'm coming near to you through the blood of Jesus. And I apply that blood to my mind and to my will and to my intellect, to every cell in my body, Lord, to my rooftop and doorpost, just like they offered the blood of lambs and goats at the time, a sacrifice. This was as a copy, the Passover blood. So the death angel and everything of the death realm would pass over. So I apply the blood to my rooftop and doorposts and our vehicles and the food I eat and the water I drink, every cell in my body, every second, every conversation, all the work of my hands. And it's the blood, it's the blood, it's the blood. That, because the Bible tells us in Hebrews that the blood of Jesus speaks. And it speaks a better word. So if you want to see something change in your communication, you want to see something change in the way you think, apply the blood. Because it cleanses you of the guilty conscience. It cleanses you of the past. It cleanses you of everything of the death realm. It works. The blood is constantly speaking a better word over your situation, a better word over your finances, a better word over your children that you're also concerned of. It's the blood of Jesus. There's been a price that's paid. We declare the blood of Jesus. And you know, if you look at it from the dark side, the witches and the ones that are doing warfare on the other side, they say they can't get in because of the blood. I can't get into that home. I have no access point because they prayed the blood of Jesus. Game's over. I'm out of here. I can't get, there's no entrance because that person is covered by the blood. Anybody in spiritual warfare, those witches or warlocks do on the dark side, they will say they can't get in the blood of Jesus. So it's real. You get somebody coming to your house and they're not cleaned up yet, you pray the blood of Jesus against that spirit and say, you'll not cross the bloodline. And they know. Amen. So we, again, the blood, we could preach, I could preach a whole message just on the blood of Jesus. But then we're moving on to C. Thank you, Lord. I want to come into your presence. I want to be with you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, I have access through the precious blood. Thank you, the blood speaking a better word. And thank you for this cross. And unless you have an understanding of the cross, you're not going to get anything else. Everything that was purchased and paid for us, every blessing, every benefit, it was purchased for you on the cross of Calvary. You have a covenant. How many have a marriage covenant? You know it's yours because you have a marriage covenant. I'm worth a lot because I have a covenant with Gil Guder. I have a good covenant going here. It is forever and ever and ever. When I stood at the altar and I said, I do, I knew what that meant. Amen. We have covenant, and the blood of Jesus came as a new and a better covenant. This is your covenant. This is your testimony. If I want to know what's mine, I'm going to have to go in one of his drawers in his office and figure out all the legal talk and find out what actually is mine. I have covenant. There are stuff with my signature on it. He gets me signing stuff every single week. I say, just tell me where. I'm going, boy, good thing I trust you, because, oh my goodness, I could have signed my life away so many times. But it's just, I sign on the dotted line, I don't know how many times. It's just like I sign, we have a covenant, and this is our covenant. So if it's written in the Bible says every promise is says it's yes to you and amen. Just before you're even asking, God is going, what are you going to say? What are you going to ask? It's yes. You find it in here, and it's a good thing. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Amen. Where there's no shadow, there's no trick, there's no fine print at the bottom. We have a covenant. And so we need to know what is ours. And so when your body gets attacked, it's like, excuse me, I have a covenant. He's taken my sicknesses, Isaiah 53, and he bore them in his body on the cross. He took all my weaknesses, all my infirmities, all my sicknesses, all my diseases, and carried them in his body on the cross. For he was wounded for my transgressions, bruised for my iniquity. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by his stripes on his back, I was healed. So sometimes you got to do a little bit of warfare, because the devil's pretending he's not buying that. He's just wondering if you really believe it in Jesus' name. So that's why we have a sword of the Spirit. We got to do warfare with it. We got to declare it over our homes. That's been paid for. It's bought and paid for. And once we know our covenant, it's like God. And then we say, Father, in Jesus' name, whatever it's going to take, you get it over here. Amen. You bring the angels through. Do whatever you have to. But I thank you. This is mine. My children, my sons and daughters, are taught of the Lord, and great shall be their peace, for the chastisement of their peace was upon him, and by his wounds they were healed, in Jesus' name. Now, sometimes you can't do warfare for everybody. How does that work? It's like they got to get it, and you've got to make up your mind to say, as long as I have breath, I will confess this. I've said before the Lord, before when I've been doing warfare over certain things, Father, when I stand before you, when this is all over, you won't be able to say to me, you didn't put that word forth and you didn't believe it. Because I'm saying it to your face right now. I'm coming to your presence. I have this confidence, and that's why I'm coming. And I'm coming with the blood, and I'm coming with my covenant, and I know what Jesus paid for on the cross for me. So Lord, here it is right here, and here's my signature, and here's your signature in blood. And so I thank you, Father. I'm entrusting you. You begun that good work. You're bringing it to completion in the name of Jesus. I know you brought this thing together. I don't understand what's going on here, but the blood is speaking a better word, and there is a price, and you paid for it, body, soul, and spirit. When you died on the cross, he said, it is finished. So that's everything. He said, bought and paid for. And then he proved it by taking his blood to the Father, presenting it to the Father. Amen. And he ever lives to make intercession for us. So there's just an amazing transaction. So I don't start my quiet time without acknowledging that he wants to be with me, and that, Lord, I'm here because I need you and I love you and I want this to be real. I don't want this to be religious. I want to know I've met with Jesus today. So, Lord, I thank you for your presence right here and now in Jesus' mighty name. I thank you for your blood that speaks a better word, and I won't go through all the things that, again, that I prayed the blood for. And I thank you for what that covenant that I have. I am a child of the Most High God because I've cut covenant with you, Almighty God. And so I thank you all these things that are mine in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, because I got a word on it. So you get a word on it. Hallelujah. The cross. Praise God. And then flipping over. I could preach this I don't know how many ways, because this is so awesome, because this is who we are, people. We are so dependent on this. It's like seeing a whole bunch of sick people and you're going, it's really quite easy. What are you eating? Tell me about your lifestyle. And you're just going, there's no way you can be healthy eating this, living this way. But the Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. They just don't know. They don't know that why they're not getting it. They're not getting why life isn't working and why their prayer life isn't working. They're just kind of barging in. They have no protocol. Thanking God, affirming their love, affirming their covenant, the blood. So this is so important. Next, I got D for delight. Delight yourself in what he's already done. In other words, this, I preached it a different way. Hallowed be your name. We could do it through the Lord's Prayer. Hallowed be your name, for his name is everything he is and everything he's ever done. Thank you that you're my righteousness because of the blood. Thank you, you begun a good work in each and every one I'm going to pray for this morning, Father. You begun a good work in them. I got their names on my fridge. Hallelujah. I am praying for them, Lord. I thank you. You're Jehovah Makedesh. You brought them in here. You begun a good work, oh God. Only you can bring it to completion. You're Jehovah Makedesh, a sanctifier. And Jehovah Rapha, you are my healer. You paid a price on the cross for my healing. I thank you, Lord, right now, if there's any sickness, any disease, anything unhealthy going on in my body, life is swallowing up death right now as we speak. And then I go through it. I go through everything from the top of my head, every hair on my head, my nails, they need prayer. Sometimes they need prayer. I pray over my joints. There's nothing wrong with my joints, but I don't intend to have anything wrong with my joints. I pray the blood of Jesus over my cholesterol. I don't have any cholesterol issues, but I pray the blood of Jesus over my adrenal glands, and they need a little bit of help once in a while. And I pray the blood of Jesus over my digestion, everything from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, and everyone in here. Hallelujah. Amen. He's our healer. He's Jehovah Roi, our shepherd. Lord, I thank you. We have a good shepherd, as Danielle sang. He leads and guides us into all truth. Isn't he so awesome? Amen. The Lord's our shepherd. We'll lack no good thing, Lord. And I go through the whole psalm. I lack no good thing because you're a good shepherd. You lead and guide me. Green pastures and quiet waters today. You restore my soul today. You're leading and guide me into green pastures, quiet waters. Amen. Go through the thing. All that the Lord has done as a shepherd. Jehovah Jireh, you're my provider. You're Jehovah Shalom, my peace. You're Jehovah Shammah, your manifested presence is here today and with me all day. You're the Alpha and Omega. Again, I made it real simple. ABCs all the way down to Z. He's everything from A to Z. He's the Alpha. He's the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's my bridegroom. He's my comforter and counselor. He's my deliverer. He's my defender. He's eternal God and everlasting Father. He's a faithful witness and the firstborn of the dead. He is the King of glory. He is the King of kings. He is the Lord of lords. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. He's a mighty God, Yeshua, my Messiah. He is the name above every other name. He is Jehovah Nissi. He is omnipotent and omnipresent and omniscient. He's propitiation of my sin. He's the pioneer and perfecter of your faith. He's your righteousness. He's your Savior. He's your soon coming King. He's my everything, and I will exalt him. He is high and lifted up. I'm telling you, I pray myself happy. If that doesn't make you happy, I don't know what will. Because he's everything. Amen. And sometimes I just go, sometimes I get a gap and I say, okay, Father, how does this work? Holy Ghost, how does this work? And he will show you. He gives us the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us into all truth. So we delight ourselves in what he's already done. E, enter his gates with thanksgiving. That is an incredible part of your prayer life. We do that when we go to bed every night. We pray together before we go to sleep. But we thank God for ordinary things. Like, thank you for our warm, comfy bed. We have a new bed. It's a big king bed. I'm telling you, this is a comfy bed. I used to sleep in a horrible bed all those pregnant years. And I wake up, oh my goodness. We got up from the day we were married, a cheap old bed. It's like, we got to do something about it. First thing I wanted when I had my own money is I'm going to buy a bed. A comfy bed to sleep in. Anyways, thank the Lord for comfy beds. Do you have a comfy bed? Do you ever sleep on a really horrible one, like go to Cuba or something? And it's like, oh God, these bones. It's like these hip bones, there's no cush whatsoever in some of these mattresses. So it's like, thank you for my bed. Thank you for my yummy food. I could just open my fridge and it's all green. It's really good. You'll find lots of green in my fridge and rainbow. You'll find everything. You know what? Thank you, Lord. Because it was a day I didn't just eat what healthy food is, what as much as you want. Fruit and veggies and meat. And we can make anything we want for supper. It's like, is that a blessing? Yeah. Amen. Thank you for food, oh God. Thank you for my husband. That I have a husband. Every day he whistles, he goes out the door and he goes to work. Happy. That is amazing. And he does good out there. How much to make today? Oops, sorry. We're in this together. Amen. It's so good. It's so exciting. Where's my thing? Is it on? Here we go. Sorry. I get kind of excited when I talk about him. I've been married, I think, 40. Is it 46? Something like that. I'm not very good at dates. He's better than that at me. But it's like, you know what? I thank the Lord for a husband. He's a good provider and he's a good protector, and that's not to be taken for granted. Amen. And so we thank the Lord for children and grandchildren. We thank the Lord for a car to drive, and thank the Lord for that you can walk and be healthy and go for a nice nature walk that day. Thank you, God, for my Bible. Thank you, God, that I have nice neighbors. Thank you. You could just be thankful, and it's so important to enter his gates with thanksgiving. Not like, yeah, sometimes you wake up, no, not snow again. It's like, at least we have a nice warm house. We can turn the heat on. It's just so easy to be grumpy, isn't it? Isn't it easier to be grumpy than to be thankful? So that is an important part of prayer. And then F. I've got F in two places here because I couldn't quite decide. But in 1 Corinthians, oh no, it's not. It's 1 Timothy 2:1. I think I have that here. Yes. I urge you first. So first things first. The Bible says first. I urge you first of all that petitions and prayers and intercessions and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and it pleases God, our Savior. So God's telling, I'm going to tell you what's good and what pleases me. And I'm going to tell you what to pray for first. Because it's sort of our covering. Right? So that's why it's so important to say, Father, so I thank you. I pray for Donald Trump first because at least I have some hope and prayer and that he's doing something good. Maybe I'm not supposed to preach politically, but it's too late. I already did. He's not perfect and I would, you know, change a lot of things. But I'm thankful for some of the changes that he's making. So I pray the blood of Jesus over him as he's meeting with all these world leaders. I pray for Justin Trudeau in Jesus' name. How many believe we're to pray for him and bless him and pray that God will send prophets their way right down to the mayors of our cities and towns in Canada. God, we stand on guard for Canada in Jesus' name. We're to pray for them first and then right down to the rank, to every nursing home, home, every doctor and nurse and every truck driver that's driving, every grade school, high school, university campus. I just pray over the whole wide world. Pray right down the ranks, amen? But we're to pray for those in authority first. How many believe that if we keep praying, if the whole world and every Christian prayed for Putin, that maybe he could get saved, amen? And even Kim Jong, maybe he could even get saved. Wouldn't that be awesome? And it's like, guess what? It's because we took our authority and said, blinding demons, get off. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe, God, your arm's stronger. Your arm's not too short to save. So we do pray for that first and foremost. But the Lord's Prayer also says, Father, forgive us. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive one another. You got to include that in your prayer. It's like, oh yeah? So then do you forgive so-and-so for what they said yesterday and how they said it? It's like, God, I choose to forgive and bless in Jesus' name. Lord, give me wisdom how to pray for them, because the Bible says to pray for our enemies even. For those who despitefully use you, even saying all manner of evil against you for his name's sake, I bless them and I forgive them. Help us to walk in love and unity and forgiveness today in Jesus' name. Forgive before the day even starts, because most days somebody doesn't do something they should have, or something happens. And if you've already said, that's okay, I already forgave them, Lord. When I got up this morning, I already forgave them, because you knew that was going to happen. I'm not getting stuck today. I'm smarter than that. We are as wise as a serpent and innocent as a dove. We say, nice try, devil. I don't know how many times he tried to catch me just on the weekend. I go, yeah, nice try, devil. I see where you're coming from. You're not distracting me in Jesus' name. Amen. So we forgive. And then we're told we can, give. Give us this day our daily bread. There is actually a part, and many people start that way. They come before God's throne of grace, and they start saying, okay, God, give me a good day. Give me this. Help, bless the work of my hands. Give me, give me, give me. And they didn't go through all the other things. It's like, you don't do that. You don't come into somebody's house and say, hey, Val, got any of that chocolate cake? Got any? What do you got in your cupboards here? What do you got going here? It's like, excuse me, where's your manners? Whoever taught you manners? I know if I stay for a few minutes and we're making small talk and she's my friend, I'm not going to go too long, but she's just, can I get you something like a coffee or tea? Like, yeah, that would be nice. But we don't come into God's presence saying, give me. But there is a part we can get to say, give me this day my daily bread. And that is, what did Jesus say? I've got bread you don't know anything about. What was Jesus' bread? What really made his day? When he said, I know it's because he spent time in his Father's presence. He said, I have to go through Samaria. And he had to meet with a woman. He said he had to go that way. And then he says, they said, where are we going to, did you have lunch or anything, Jesus? He says, I've got bread, you know nothing about. I've had lunch with this lady. Oh my goodness, if you could see what's going to happen now. That was Jesus' bread. But we're also told we can ask for things. We can ask to give us our daily bread. We can say, bless the work of our spouse's hands. Bless. We can ask for things. And it's so beautiful. The Lord says in his word, you don't have because you don't ask. So it is an important part of prayer that we get to ask. And it's a beautiful privilege to give. Bread is our deliverance. When Jesus talked to the woman who wanted deliverance for her child, and Jesus said, the bread is for the children of Israel. And she says, well, even the dogs get the crumbs under the table. And there's been times I said, Lord, a crumb would do it. But I am your child, and I have a covenant with you. So, Lord God, I'm not settling for a crumb. I'm asking, give us this day our daily bread. Give deliverance. I'm praying for deliverance. Deliverance is our healing. Our bread is our healing. Our bread is deliverance. Our bread is to do the will of the Heavenly Father. Jesus said, this is my bread, to do the will of the Heavenly Father. So that's as far as I got on the alphabet. And that doesn't mean that's all there is to prayer. It doesn't mean there's all to prayer, but it's like, how do we have that quiet time What pleases our Father? What's a way to come into His presence? And I just can't even emphasize enough to just say, just do it. I mean, I'm sure there were times, the Bible says Jesus was tired. You're not always going to wake up going, yay, put the coffee on, do what you have to. You know, there's, I just think even positioning yourself, if I get too comfy, I will get sleepy, and before you know it, I'm not praying very good. So to keep this body in its place where I'm concentrating, I pray with my eyes open, I pray by a window, I pray on my knees, and I pray with a voice, because I don't want to lose my track. Amen. And so we pray all those things, and then I'm praying over each and every single one of you. I pray the blood of Jesus over everyone here, over every area that I just pray over myself. The work of your hands, your coming and going, your vehicles as you go off to work, mamas as they're at home. I'm praying the blood of Jesus over your quiet time, over the food you eat and your water, drink, and your little ones. I pray over your communication. I'm praying over these things because we want a strong church to arise. And there's no other way to get strong but to spend time in His presence. Nothing's changed me more than spending the time with Jesus. None of us are superheroes. Heroes in of ourselves. Even Jesus needed to spend time with His Father. And this instant when they finally found Jesus, when He went away in a solitary place to pray, to be with His Father, they said, Jesus, we've been looking everywhere for you. Don't you know there's a big lineup already? Amen. And He said, well, let's go to some of the smaller towns for this very reason. I came here to preach the good news. He didn't get sidetracked because He had spent time with His Father. He knew what the plan was that day. Amen. And there's times I do that. I go, I have an agenda to follow. I'll look at the phone. I say, sorry, I'm not getting that today. Don't answer that phone. I'll say to Gil, I yelled out last night, I didn't want to talk to this pastor from London. I didn't want to talk to him. I need this time with my Father. Sorry, I'll call him Monday. Amen. And we set our course when we get in prayer, and we're like, straight ahead. So if you're looking for change, I don't care where you're sitting, you're looking for something to change in your life. You need to develop that intimacy with the Father. You need to develop a prayer life. And I can tell you, I've raised 5 little ones, homeschooled them, and was going to Bible school and taking care of a household. But you know what? There was times I'm tempted. I got a lot to do today, but it's like I'm having my quiet time first. The kids knew where I would be. It's like Mama's having her quiet time. It's 6:30. They don't need breakfast. They can have their little whatever. I'll give them a drink, whatever. But it's like Mom, we're not getting breakfast until Mom's had her prayer time and her time in the Word. Amen. Nothing happens in our house. Doesn't matter if we're getting up at 4 in the morning to go to the airport. I need prayer. What time do you need to wake up tomorrow, Gil says. And I tell him, I need that hour of prayer. I need time to lift up every single one of you. There's been times, yeah, shortcuts, and it's like, see? One time John landed going to the hospital with a concussion because I had kind of slept a little longer than I think I slept till 6 before we were meeting for prayer at 7 in the morning. And that day he landed up in the hospital, couldn't see, everything was black. I said, John, read this. He says, I can't see, Mom. I'm going, oh my goodness. And he had a concussion, and it was like, I'm driving this big club wagon home, and I said, Lord, we need to talk. It's like, this was not supposed to happen. I prayed this morning, and the Lord brought to my mind what my morning quiet time was before we set off into warfare over the whole geographical area. And it was like, I said, really, Lord, honestly, one morning, I didn't get that prayer time. And the Lord said, well, my mercies are new every morning. It's like the enemy stands ready to rob, to kill, and to destroy. And I'm telling you, he'll come after your kids, he'll come after your marriage, he'll come after anything, any area where you don't know your covenant, he's coming after it. So we need that time. And aside from all of that, it's the most lovely place to be. You want to get close to heaven? You get a moment on earth as it is in heaven. It's like, you know what? This is sacred time. right there by my living room window. It's sacred time. This is a sacred place. This is where it all happens. This is where vision comes. This is where supernatural comes. You can't. Jesus said, I can do nothing without the Father. And you can't either. Amen. I can't do anything. I can't bring you this word and say, okay, I'm just preaching something where I found something on the internet. No, I didn't. I live this. This is everything to me. Take everything away and stick me. I don't care if I'm 105 years old. Nobody will ever be able to take that away from me. I can have a little corner anywhere in the world, and as long as I can see the sky, even if I can, I usually like to see the sky when I'm praying. But you know what? Nothing can ever take that away. That's my bread. That's my everything. That's my sustenance. I am dead without prayer. And so are you. Amen. If we're going to grow any revivals, anybody that's done anything great for God, including Jesus, needed time with his Father. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Now, how many here are going to be a doer of this word? Amen. You're going to be a doer. Amen. So if you can't start out with an hour, you don't have to pray for everybody in the congregation, because we all have different parts. But you can say, I need to pray. I got little ones under my charge. You need to pray. If you're a young mom, if you're a young dad, you need to pray. There's no way you're going to get where you are to where you want to go without prayer life. Amen. Amen. Amen, Paul? Amen. Amen? Amen. How are we going to see these breakthroughs? We need breakthroughs. There's a few people here that need a breakthrough. How are we going to get a breakthrough? By being a doer of that word. That place of power, that place of prayer, it's everything. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I can't get.